very often, could I? I was all right, and I came on, I went, oh, I'm a twat, and just suddenly lost all self-respect again, Leo again. I'm in danger of being overexcited, so please don't hit clapping, because tonight you're playing in Bracknell again. It's a career peak for me, and I couldn't be happier. Your applause couldn't make me any happier, especially if someone's had the good sense to leave loads of rolls of lino on the stage. And for me, that says showbiz. That and the Danny LaRue entrance just behind it, that's all I could ever wish for at a comedy gig. Thanks a lot for coming. Recently, I went in to buy some fags in the supermarket, and I paid with my credit card, and the woman looked at the credit card and had my name on it, and she went, is this a joke? And I didn't get it, right? And I said, what? I don't get it. And she went, Mark Lamar. And I said, yeah, I don't get it. And she went, no, because you look like him as well. So what? Oh, what's happened to you? The bloke's got a big brace around his stomach. It looks like, you know, like most of his ribs have been broken. I said, what's happened to you? And he went, like he'd forgotten. What's happened?
Broken back.
Fucking hell, that's such an honour that you've come with a broken back. You've come from. Wow. How did you break it? That's fascinating. I've never had a broken back. Not many people have they? They all have. Oh, we've had broken backs, yeah. We're brilliant. We've broken all of our bones loads of times. But, oh, he's sat with a broken back and he's wearing a brace. A lot of us wouldn't bother with that. We're so hard. We're so fantastic. We're perfect human beings. What happened? Don't keep looking down. You know what it is. Just going, oh, what about the back? Or you just like my T-shirt?
Yeah, I laughed too much. It hurts.
Oh, no, of course. You're not allowed to laugh. Right, you come to the right show. Then. That's already the worst review I've ever had. I could have sat in tonight watching videos of Les Dennis, but I'm not allowed to laugh too much, so I thought I'd come and watch you. And sit in the front row as well in pain, that's what I wanted. Instead of sitting at the back grimacing, I'm going to sit at the front. Every time you do a joke, everyone else is laughing, I'm going to go... You know, sometimes you go into a chip shop and you go, I'll have a bag of chips, and they go, oh, you'll have to wait for chips. Yeah, what the fuck have you been playing around at today? What were you thinking of when you came in and saw the deep fat fryer and the potatoes? What did you think? The chip fairies in town, you lazy bastards? Anyway, I'll start the show any second now, so I'm just warming myself up into a bundle of spite. But before I start the show properly, I just want to tell you a quick story about myself and tell you why I don't really deserve to be here having this public platform and talking to you kind people. You know, sometimes in life you do things and you think, right, I'm a wanker. I know that now, we all are, but this I've done as bad as an embarrassing thing as I can possibly ever do. And the one I'd done before, I've done a terrible one recently, but I did one once and I was walking down the road and Brian Ferry, was in West End of London, Brian Ferry was walking towards me and I was with my mate and I don't know how it happened, I didn't mean to do it, but just as Brian, I didn't sort of go, look, Brian Ferry, I was pretty cool, but as soon as Brian Ferry got parallel, like right next to us. I turned to my friend, don't know how it happened, I went, we are flying down to Rio. And I don't know why or how or what I was thinking of. I'm not really loud or anything. I'm not sure if he heard, but there was a little bit, you know, I think, you know, he probably gets it 200 or 300 times a day. And he's thinking, I heard it again, I'm sure I did, you know. But, and I thought that was it for me. I thought, right, that's as low as I can be as a human being. That's as embarrassing as it can get. But, oh, Lordy, I've done so much worse. I went to watch Noel's house party. And believe me, that's the high point of the story. It really drops off from now on. I went to watch Noah's house party because the Spice Girls were on. And I thought, oh, I'm going to meet the Spice Girls. I really did think it like that. Even when I wasn't saying it, I was going, I'm going to meet my girl. And it's quite an incredible thing, seeing that many people with learning difficulties in one room. And I went in, and they have this warm-up bloke. They have a warm-up bloke who comes on at the beginning. He's not a comedian. He doesn't make the audience laugh or anything. He comes on dressed in a rustic outfit, and his name's Bertie the Bugler, and he comes on, and he goes, hello, Quickly Bottom, I'm Bertie the Bugler. Do you want me to play my bugle? They're fucking over the moon with this. They're like... They're, that's so exciting. And he plays a bit of perfunctory bugle. Mayhem. Oh, they go crazy about it. And then he goes up to people in the audience and he goes, do you want to play my bugle? And they're thinking something for nothing. I'll have a go, you know, and they go, no. And they can't play the bugle. Like, who can? Who wants to, you know? But he hands it to her and they go, and he goes, that weren't very good, was it, Crinkly? Like he's the panpipe king of the universe or something. Like he's somehow better than these people in the audience. But anyway, now they're in the right mental zone for the rest of the show. And anything else, anything that Noel does is a big whoosh up for them after that. So I'm stood there watching it, and I'm dazed, and I'm thinking, what's going on here? And then I turn around, and Noel Edmonds is stood next to me, and I didn't notice, because he's a little, he's like an Oompa Loompa, and he just snuck up on me. And suddenly I turn around, and there's little orange Noel there, and he said to me, hello, and I wasn't thinking, I went, hello, which that pissed me off, because my whole life has been built up to meeting him and saying, look, would you fuck off out of my sight, you talentless bucket of shit, and I never, at the time, wasn't thinking of it, so that embarrassed me. So I made it, I tried to get away, I sneaked off, you know, a little, just sort of sidled away, and he had to run to keep up, and then, you know, I got away from him fairly quickly. And then I met the Spice Girls, and that was all very exciting, and a sort of 14-year-old boy having a wank, basically. hello. That was that. And so I'm thinking, my evening's not too bad, you know, I've done what I set out to do. And then I was just about to leave, and someone said, Yuri Geller was on the show, and someone said, Mark, do you want to come and meet Yuri? And I didn't particularly, you know, I'm not a fan, who is? You know, oh, Yuri, I love the way you can bend stuff for no apparent reason or gain or whatever, but I didn't want to be rude, I didn't want to be impolite, so I went, yeah, all right. And he said, hello, it's like, Mark, Yuri, Mark. He put his hand out to shake my hand, and as he did, I put my hand out, and I don't know how it happened, but I suddenly went, whoa! And that, you know, that was the end of the road for me, basically. In the shame stakes, it doesn't get much worse than that, I don't think. Every comedian, when they do a show, they always hope that it's going to be, not only for us, but for the audience, it's going to be like one of the greatest nights of all time. And in the interval, you'll be chatting with each other, like, oh, I can't wait to get back in and watch some more of that. And in months to come, you might see each other walking around Bracknell and you go, oh, you're at that show, that was the most important night of my life. And get him in a headlock, well, come on, go and have a drink. And blood grubbers, maybe a little bit of, you know, splitting there. Maybe some of you would have kids, name them after me. And for years to come, there'll be a maypole set up in the middle of Bracknell and you could all dance around it on this date and sing my name. That's the dream. Obviously, I'm not that good. You've probably sussed that so far. So what I'd be happy with is if any of you see each other in the street, recognise each other from this gig, if you could, all right? That'll be enough for me, really. That's as much as I'm looking for. There is a kind of a theme to the show tonight, which is growing up. I was 30 this year, and I don't know how many of you are 30 or have been or will be at some point. Probably all of you. No, not at all. So how many of you think you're adults? How many of you think you're growing up? You fucking are. You never were me. Believe me, when you leave here tonight, that's the end of your life. We've got the addresses of all of you. You're in big trouble. I'm coming around your house afterwards and shouting through the letterbox. I don't know what, but something funny I'll think of later on. I should have thought of something funny then. I realise I should have gone and shout, you know, gherkins or something for your letterbox and then petrol bomb your house, but I hadn't thought of it at that point, and it wasn't. By the end of the show, I'll have thought of something really funny to shout through his letterbox. What's your name? Right, I'll shout, you know, Ben or something. But something funnier, you know, like Ben Dover or something. You know, something, I don't know. Well, I'll just kick his fucking head in. I don't know what I'll do. That'll save me having to think of something funny then. I'll just kick him in the face and then that'll be the... Oh, it's getting aggressive now, isn't it? Isn't it, Ben? Oh, Ben, you pitiful waste of humanity. You really are. Sorry?
That's why you're a comedian and I'm not.
Yeah, that's why I do the talking and you shut your fucking mouth. Surely that's about the same rule, isn't it? I'm only kidding, Ben. Not about the punching your face in, but just about the shot. Anyway, when I was younger, I always thought that by the time I was 30, I would be a man, and that's all I've ever wanted to be in life. I've never wanted to be successful or entertainer, and that seems to have worked out as well, but all I ever wanted to be was a man. I wanted to be like my dad, and because he was a grown man. And how many men are in tonight, by the way? Say, like, one. And you could tell he was a man because he went... Which doesn't count, really, because men... There's a thing about being a man. You can't, unless you've, like, swum the channel or something like that, or you're Spartacus or something, you're not allowed to be called a man. There's some weird... And, like, Spartacus, who was going to lead this revolt? If it had been you... You know, it's not quite so cool as Charlton Heston, are you, really? But you're not allowed to call yourself a man. Only one man in here had the nerve to go like that. And women, you're allowed to be women. How many women are in tonight? See? Like, a dozen. There's like women. Women, you're allowed to call yourself a woman. If you have the old, when Mr. Blobby comes to town, you're a woman, and that's fair enough. You can give birth to another human being. You're allowed to call yourself an adult. But men aren't allowed to do it at any point in their lives. And that's all I wanted to be when I was a kid. I wanted to be my dad. He could do all man things, you know. He could wear overalls and put up shelves and stuff like that. And I just think, God, one day I'll be able to put up shelves. That was my dream. I thought one day your voice drops and your balls drop and you go and put up shelves and no one... No one teaches you. You can just put up shelves for the rest of your life. And he could fix the car. I can't fix a car. And no one ever taught my dad to fix a car. But it wouldn't work. And he'd look under the bonnet and he'd twist something and it would work. He just knew because he was a man. I know now he'd untwist it the night before to show off to us. You know, I know now. But still, a cool man. And I always wanted to be a man. And in our society, we don't have a point where we can say we're a man. You know, in primitive tribes, they say, like, you know, leave the tribe, go and fend for yourself, go off into the desert and kill a deer. And not in the desert, in the forest. In a desert, that would be a real hard one, wouldn't it? And, well, what does it look like? You just find one. You want to be a man in the forest, go and kill a deer and make yourself a hut and fend for yourself and you can be a man, and that's fair enough. We don't have that. And I always thought that'd be nice if we had that. And then I saw this documentary on TV about this tribe in Papua New Guinea, this fantastic tribe called the Matsos tribe. Very primitive, and they all, you know, live in huts and canoeing and hunting and stuff like that. And they have all these weird little rituals. They have one, when the women, when it's time for them to menstruate, they all menstruate at the same time. You know, women will do that when, you know, together, when they live together. No, you don't know that, but they do. That's a rule of natural life, is that women will all menstruate. When it's a full moon, it's time for them. It's true. That's absolutely true. I know you're looking at me like you're a buffoon, but it is. I've researched this in my mind. And I know you're a woman, and you're thinking, oh, I know better than you about that business, but... This is a fact that women will naturally, when it's a full moon, that's the title, moonstraw or something, I don't know what it is, but there is, and all the women in this tribe, how do you, that's when they know, when you know, it's a full, it's like showbiz, no, it's not bollocks, it's absolutely, oh, well, you've done studies on this, have you now? You fucked me off twice now, it's three strikes and you're out, I'm telling you. No, it's absolutely true. That's naturally, when I know you're all looking at me dazed, and not only that, but you're thinking, why are you even mentioning this? But it's true. Nuns, for example, nuns all, you know, come on at the same time. And it's true. Do you think this is just all a really elaborate wind-up? But I've brought you all here to tell you a farcical fact of nature, and then you're all going to leave, and I'm going to be going, oh, I got one up on that stupid crowd. It's a fact. And these women, that's when, you know, it's like showbiz, they're like, lights were on. And these women go off into the forest, and then they sit in their menstrual hut, which isn't made from menstrual, it's a hut where they sit and they... And that's how they know. I don't know how you know, like, you seem to be some expert on it, but... I don't know how you know. How do you know when you've come on? Is it because men don't know? None of us. He probably does. Old fucking Malfi down there. Don't know much about Livingston, but the old menstrual cycle. This man's an expert. Any of the women in the audience have got any problems down below? He's the man to go and check it out. No, you're not on yet. I don't know if that's the way you do it, but. How do you know is what I want to know. How do you, is it like, because men don't know. Even if you were a gynecologist, you wouldn't have a man would, oh, I don't want to, you know, but is it like a suction? Oh, can you feel it being pulled out of you? Or is it a trickle? Is it a trickle? Is it a... Anyway, so how do you know? Go on, tell me. Because when I was talking about it, you were going, oh no, fool. You don't have to talk about it. Fair enough. It's a comedy club, fair enough. But you have had one. Because that would be, you know, if you went a few months, I know, like, when you're pregnant, you go a few months without having one, but if you just naturally did, that would build up a lot of pressure, wouldn't it? Whoa! Head for the hills! The next Spice Girls video, there when they're doing all the kicks, put a ball and just firing stuff out at the cameraman. It's a beautiful idea. Anyway, so that's all I'm saying. I'm just setting up what the scene for this tribe. Whether you believe it or not, this is what happens. They all the women go off and they menstruate and they sit in their hut and do whatever you lot do during that time. And the men, they're not allowed in the hut. But I don't think they'd want to go, to be honest. You know, I can't imagine them out in the forest playing darts or something. Let's go and check up on the girls. I don't think they'd be, you know, too pleased to see them. But what they do, the men put sticks up their noses and make themselves bleed. And it's a beautiful thing that they do. And they don't get all ratty the week before. They just do it. They don't moan about, oh, I can't do anything with my hair. You don't love me or anything like that. They just do it and get on with their business. And it's a beautiful thing. Anyway. When it's time for the young boys to become men, when they're 7 years old, that's when they first learn to become men. They learn all the tricks of the trade. Go off into the forest and kill a deer and make yourself a rude hut. And the final part of the process is they have to get all the strength and knowledge and wisdom from the elders of the tribe, these old men that have been involved in many battles and killed many deer and made many rude huts and stuff. And the way they get this strength and knowledge and wisdom is they have to drink the mystical fluid of the semen. They have to drink the semen of the... Is this true? I don't, you can go as much as you want, but this is what happens in this tribe. And I don't know if any of you know anything about drinking semen. I'm hoping to God it's not completely out of fashion nowadays, but there's only one method, and that's from the tap. And the 7-year-old boys, before they're allowed to become men, they have to gobble off the old men of the tribe, and it's the mystical fluid, and it makes them strong and wise, apparently, and that's the excuse that the old men use anyway. did no one see this documentary? You're looking at me like you got a sick, diseased mind. This actually occurs in the world nowadays. And because the funniest bit in the documentary was when they were interviewing one of the blokes and they said, did this happen to you? And he said, no, I didn't do it. I heard about it and I didn't get involved. You know, it wasn't my cup of tea. Or whatever. He didn't say that, but he just said, I didn't get involved. I ran off and left the China thing. And they said, what, not even once? And he went, who told you? And that was, you know, I thought, if that's what it takes to be a man, you know, I'm not that interested, mate, to be honest. I can leave it there. I think it's a working system, because in our society, our elders are our bosses or our teachers or whatever, and if we were late for work on a Monday, you know, 9:05, and the boss is going, oh, you're late, it doesn't really matter, 5 minutes. But you do have to know that this job is what provides you with your living. You need the strength and knowledge and wisdom to cope with that thought. You need to get your fucking... Go on, get your head down there. Go on, get cracking. Because if that was the system we live by, none of you would be late for work on a Tuesday. That's all I'm saying. All at once or not at all, believe me. There's nothing worse than... It was very kind of you to start the clapping then, but it was very unkind of the rest of you to not continue it. Really, there's nothing a comedian hates more than hearing one person clap, because it's like, Mark, I love that bit. I'm really up with you. What you were just saying now, for it was very amusing. The rest of the audience not so keen. That's what I'm doing here. I'm just pointing that out. That's all. I was just trying to talk, and this beetle started walking across the stage, and he's got all fluff on his back, and he's having a hard time. But the thing is, I feel like he's really bored with the show, and he's trying to fuck off. So that's, he just keeps wandering around and going, I'm not into this menstrual stuff. I'm not really. And he's got all fluff on him. He's just wandering around in circles, and I know exactly how he feels at the moment. He's not like a sacred beetle from this part of the country, is he? Not one of you brought in the sacred Bracknell beetle. And if I get, you know, if I say anything out of turn, he just goes into a really big beetle and hits me or something like that. I know it's fairly unlikely, isn't it? I'm just musing here, but... You know what? I've noticed that I'm wasting your time, aren't I? You know, I was staring at me going, oh, he's got some great beetle stuff going on. I'm sure he has, but no, I just... That would be so sad, wouldn't it, if I said to the stagehand, let the beetle on now, I can do me beetle stuff. No, I was just trying to talk about that, and the beetle went across, and I just suddenly showed a little interest in nature there. He's going to fall in a minute. Would you try and catch him? Because if he breaks his back down near you, that's bad. I don't want the two of you down there. He's lying on his back, and you're going, no, you're fucking Phil, mate. I don't, you know, I really don't want that. I've been trying to grow up. I gave up drinking. That was one thing I did, because I'm very infantile when I drink, and I'm very hard as well. That's the other thing. I'll take on any amount of people when I'm drunk. If I'm in a bad mood or if I'm in a good mood, doesn't matter to me, really. And not just people, traffic, buildings. And, I've been outside Barclays Bank going, come on, you black or slag, I'll have you. You know, it doesn't matter to me. And there was one incident, there was a specific incident in my life when I thought, I've got to give up now. I was walking down the road one night and this Jeep pulled up alongside me. And there were six blokes in the Jeep. They recognised me, I have to tell you. And they went, you're that black, to tell you, didn't you? And I went, yeah. And they went, we're going to kill you, you're a wanker. And if I was sober, I would have thought, right, I'll make my way home now. But I'd had a drink, so I thought, oh, it's only six blokes in a Jeep. So I went over to them. And you know when you're drunk, you don't want to use your fists, or, you know, you want to use your mind. You want to show these people you're so far above them that you're not going to get involved in fisticuffs. And so whatever they say to you, you sort of twist it round and say something very witty and clever back to them. And they were going to be wanker. And I was going, look, don't wank me, I'll wank you, all right? Don't come round here giving it wank. I'll wank all six of you separately. I'll wank you all at once. Give me 20 minutes, I'll wank your Jeep, all right? So don't come round here wanking me off, because I'll wank you off, all right? And they were going wank, and I was going, look, I'll wank your families, the town you came from. Kung Fu wank, I'll show you methods of wank you've only dreamed of, lads. And I was thinking, God, I hope this red light changes. I can't think of any other ways of saying wank at the moment. And eventually they drove off, and I felt, you know, I was pretty hot with myself. I was walking down the road, and very hard, because I'd just beaten six blokes in the Jeep, and the shout wanker contest doesn't happen every day, does it? You know, and then... Then the Jeep came back round the block, and here we go. And they got out of their Jeep, and I thought, well, that's their first mistake, no Jeep. And they they came up to me, and they went, we're going to kill you. And I said, no, there's only six of you, I'm going to kill you. And they said, well, that confused them, you know. And they said, well, we've sort of, you know, set our heart on it now. And I said, well, you know, believe me, I should do the killing. Because I do get very Shakespearean when I've had a drink. So they said, do you want to fight? And I said, of course I want to have a fight. Six of you, no Jeep, about to be killed, wankers. Of course I want to fight you. And they said, all right, then come up the alley. Let's go up the alley and have a fight. Now, my rule, and it's the only bit of advice I ever give out on stage, is that if you're going to get into a fight, and you should really perk your ears up for this one, Ben, if you're going to get beaten up and you don't want to get involved, you don't want to have a fight, you know, you're just not interested in the whole thing, pick another location. Because always in a fight situation, whoever's having the fight always says where it is. Normally it's in a pub and they go, right, outside! And if you go, no, inside! They can't go, ah. Now, that is a good idea, my friend. They can't do that. They go, oh, we could leave our drinks here, our mates are here, we wouldn't have to do the walk. And if they can't do that, they've got to be angry. So I always pick somewhere else, and I always pick somewhere very difficult to get to. And that makes it a little bit harder for them. And they were going, then come on in, up the alley. And I said, no, Paraguay. And that, you know, and that confused them again. And they said, well, the alley, you know, that's handy for now. We've got to go up for work in the morning. And I said, all right, then my mum's back garden. You find it, I'll kill you all there. You're no cheap, not going to Paraguay, about to be killed, wankers. And this weird thing happened that five of them, suddenly, they'd gone from, you know, when you hate someone, the face screwed up, ready to kill, and then they suddenly started to love me. They started going, you're brilliant, you stood up to us. We did. And I was going, I'll fucking stand you, I'll show you, Stan. One leg. And I was, you know, and they were going, oh, we can't believe it. We didn't like you, but you obviously, you know, you just stood up to all of us. And you're brilliant. They were putting their arms around me, really happy with me. And one of them said, I still want to kill him. And the other five were going, no, I don't. And then I made the mistake, and the reason I had to get drinking, because what I should have thought was one-on-one. That'll be a little bit easier. But what I actually said was, look, six or nothing. You know, and that was the end of my drinking days. Have any of you ever been to court? Has anyone been to court here? Yeah, you ever before?
Not paying me rent.
For what?
Not paying me rent.
Not paying the rent, and the council took you to court?
Yeah.
Right. You're making this up, aren't you?
No.
Yeah, I went to court for not paying me rent. They put me in a Turkish prison for 15 years. I don't... Yeah, the council, yeah. And did they whip you? Yeah, whip me as well. Yeah, did they put a zebra in your cage? Yeah, zebra, yeah, whatever you say. No, it's a terribly embarrassing thing. I went a couple of years ago, I got done with speeding, and you just feel like a little kid, and you go in, and they go, have you anything to say? And you go, yeah, I'm really sorry, I'll never do it again. I've never been that fast before in my life, and it scared even me. And I don't know how it happened. I was just driving along at 47, because I don't like going any faster than that. And then I had lead leg. I had a weird medical condition, lead leg. My leg was like lead. I'd never heard of it before or since. I don't think anyone else has ever had it, but it was like lead. 130 suddenly. That's when you caught me, I know. And then suddenly, as the sort of flashing lights, the lead leg went, and I'm really sorry, and don't mind me, and I'm really apologise. And it's just an embarrassing thing. But the worst thing is, when they read out the name of your case, they go, right, the next case, the Queen versus Mark Lamar. And I thought, well, they're going to take her word, aren't they? That doesn't seem fair to me. She wasn't even there. And then lucky that lazy bitch never even turned up, so that was quite handy. I don't like the Queen. I think she's just a miserable cow. She's got the best job in Britain, isn't she? The Queen. Just wake up, still the richest woman in the world, does fuck all, and can still order us around. What a fantastic job. And does she have a grin on her face? Does she fuck? Have you ever seen the Queen out? Every day you'd wake up, I'm the fucking Queen. Fantastic. And what I hate is when the day she poses for currency, and she draw a picture of it, it's going to be on notes, not just here, all over the world, Hong Kong, Canada, Australia, whatever, picture of the Queen, you'd think that day you'd wake up with a little bit of a look at her, she's just going that day the Queen should force feed her a couple of bottles of gin. I want to see the Queen pissed out of her face just on the pound coin, just going, I'm the Queen, yeah, fucking right I am. I'd like to see her stark bollock naked, just hanging with a big monarch arse hanging down to her knees. You know, pissed, and with, you know the stripes you get when you sunbathe, and like, you normally only see it in pornography, because those women too embarrassed to go topless on the beach for quite a while to have six blokes wanking over their head for a national magazine. But wouldn't you love to see the Queen, like for the £20 note, she's just sat there, bollock naked, legs akimbo. That's your 20 quid post, go on, get cracking on that one. The £50 note. She's bent over. The arse is hanging down, but just below that is the big turkey labia. And just living the big acres of turkey neck labia hanging down there. The smell's alerted the corgis. The corgis have come running in. There's half a dozen corgis just nipping at her. They think it's fish supper. She's got one tit that ain't dangling down there, just lower than the labia, one over the shoulder, and she's turning around and she's going, that's a dream for me. You've got to have a dream. I was thinking about that going to court thing. I once read, you know, there's like weird laws that probably most of us don't know about, and you can break the law about knowing. And there's this one law that is illegal to board a moving train. If a train starts about the station, you're actually done for that. And the reason I heard about it was this woman did this. This poor woman ran for the train and missed the train and missed the platform and fell underneath the train. It's not funny. This woman lost both her legs. And the only reason I found out about it is because British Rail were thinking of prosecuting her. And I thought, this poor cow's going to wake up in hospital. You know, last thing she's remembering, late for work, running for the train, wakes up in a hospital bed, you know, no legs. There's two arseholes there from London Transport Co, British Rail, whatever, coming to interview her. And, you know, what's she going to do? She's not going to lay there and go, that weren't me. You know, I thought that was a terrible thing, wasn't it? Are there any couples in? Are there any couples in the audience? Yeah, where else? You two. And how did you meet if you don't chat? Did you just go up and stare next to each other? He probably said, oh, I haven't seen you in here before. Did you come, man? And you go, no. And he thought, oh, match made in heaven, Bracknell local. Obviously, we're going to get on together. How did you meet? Do you remember how you met?
We met at a party.
At a party. And what was his line?
We were playing strip poker.
Oh, strip poker. Oh, one of those. You don't really need a line when you're playing strip poker, do you? You got nice tits, yeah. You know what? I didn't think those parties really happened. I read about them in the News of the World when I was a kid and George Best was there, but I didn't think in real life. This is the swinging suburbs, isn't it? It's like people just playing around, so and you know, you're sitting there and you're both naked and you're going, do you want to? Yeah, fuck it, might as well. And that was it. You don't actually go out of each other. You've seen each other naked, so you might as well be. Is that, but what was his line? Was it like he just went, good hand, and you went, put it there? Or was it something like that? I've never played strip poker. I don't know how what the rules are or anything like that. In the second half of the show, I want to talk a little bit about, about my career. I've been working in showbiz for about 12 years now. I started off the golden days for me as a bingo caller, which is a lot of fun. I don't know if any of you have been to bingo. Very exciting game. And as the caller, you're the focal point. You know, there's all these old women just waiting on you every word, and it's a lot of fun. Clickety-click, 66. God, the fun we had in those days. And but you are in so much control, you know. And the one thing I realised was that if you say clickety-click, they'll cross off 66. You know, whatever you say after it, doesn't it? Yeah, say click, four. They've done it, and they hate that. They really hate that. And they throw these little blue pens at your head, and they get really angry. And you never do that in life. Never wind up the bingo caller. Because, you know, I do things like four and five, nine, things like that. They hate that, you know. Two fat ladies. Blue plastic pens. And I tried to modernise it. A lot of those numbers haven't got catchphrases, and I do, you know, I'd make up new ones for some of the numbers that didn't have them, and I'd do things like, later, winds will move in a westy direction, 62, things like that, and it, you know, I've got to admit, it never really caught on, to be honest. All of me, why not take all of me? Can't you see I'm no good without you? Eight, things like that. I've had the great pleasure of working with like a lot of showbiz greats. So when I was a kid, I was never allowed to go to gigs. Is there gigs on here? Do you have gigs in Bracknell?
Yes.
Yeah, who plays here? Sorry? You don't know. But you just heard that there's something happening. You didn't want to be involved, obviously. And no one knows?
Hecker 100.
Was this recently? Because as far as I know, this blew up about 10 years ago. So that was... Right. God, it's a cauldron of excitement then, isn't it, really? No, but I grew up in a shithole as well, I know what it's like. I grew up in Swindon, so I know exactly what it's like when no one's there. Jeffrey! I've never had that before. I'm from Swindon all my life, and I've never had that when you go, oh, I'm from Swindon. Jeffrey! Is that like a thing that you... Because you did it in unison, like you had like... Like you all belong to a club hoping to meet someone from Swindon, so yeah, you all have a song ready, and I bet you like if there was more room, you'd all have beers on your head. Hit the bay, hit the bay, hit the bay, hit the bay. What did you mean?
Oxford.
Oh, Oxford. Oh, I see. Right. I get it now. So when someone names a town, you shout out another one. It's Bracknell Tag. Isn't it? It's Bracknell Geography Tag. On a Wednesday night, you all just come out, and if you mention Bristol, we'll go for Blackburn, shall we? It's just probably, there were rules, but I like the way that you all say, are you all from Oxford?
No,
you just got an Oxford song. That's a good song as well. Now, I've got a night, because this costs a fuck of a lot of money to record all this. Like, are there any other words I might do? That, you know, like with the Beatle, you might have gone, Ladybird. I just need to know, because it could waste a lot of time. You know, I could save us all a lot of money and everything. You know? So anyone got a garden? Front lawn. Why did you do that? I've got to know. Sorry, I can't concentrate unless I know why you did that.
The football rivalry, mate.
The football rivalry between Oxford and Swindon. Oh, I didn't know about that. But you don't support either of them. You're just into punch-ups. Punch-ups, but with a sing-song too. You could make a lovely little musical, couldn't you, about the rivalry between Oxford and Swindon. You could call it... very hard to put on the poster, obviously, and so the football fans, if it just said Oxford, they wouldn't understand it. They'd have to say... And you'd spell that with like three H's and an F or something. Three H's and F and... Five R's? Is that even? I don't know. I'm just doing it phonetically. There'd be a D in there as well, wouldn't there? Three H's, a D, an F, and four, five R's, I think. Sorry? Someone was trying to correct me on my spelling there. No? I think there's an X in Oxford, actually, smart boy. And what team are you support?
United.
United, right. Do I have a fucking clue which city that belongs to? Don't a lot of towns have a United?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. You just like any of them, really. It's just the ring of the words, eh? United, it just sounds like fellowship and love. Bored with that now, sorry. I get bored of things about 5 minutes after you lot do, so like you just have to... When I've come up with an idea, you can giggle at it for a few minutes and go, yes, you've done it now, and I'll just be going... I'll start doing handstands a minute, I'll be down here just going, I wonder if I can do it as a handstand. This is the night of my life where I shouldn't be fucking around, really, isn't it? The night with all the cameras and everything, and the video and everything, but, oh, shit, I'm so bored with this fucking... I mean, then it was so... I used to do warm-ups for television programmes. That was one of the first jobs I had, and I used to go on, and you meet some brilliant people doing that. I did one once for Tom Jones, and amazing meetings, like a true legend in showbiz like Tom Jones, and he's so old as well, he's 97, I think. And you meet him, but he's a brilliant bloke, and he doesn't look like Tom Jones because he's old, and you know your face sags and gets withered, and your ears get like five times as big, and your hearing goes half. I don't know how that works, but you'd meet him, and they'd, before the gig, they'd have to put on like paper mache head so it looked like Tom Jones, and then they'd bring him on, this doddery old chap, and they'd fix him on his wheel. You know the Tom Jones wheel. You know he's got that wheel. He's like, because he can't do that dance anymore, so he has to. I don't know if they get him in the shops, but they put him on the wheel, and. And sometimes in rehearsals they'd speed it up for a laugh and you see him trying to keep his balance and stuff. But he always does put on a good show because he's senile and he thinks it's 1965 as far as he's concerned, you know, because women still throw underwear at him. But what he hasn't realised is the underwear's a lot bigger nowadays, you know, and the first few numbers he's just fighting off laundry basically. And this show I did with him, not with him but before him, was he did a soul show and he did all these classic soul songs that everyone in the audience knew, and it was brilliant, and the audience were really, and Tom's fantastic singing and everything. And the audience were stood in front of Tom singing along with the songs, everyone knew the words apart from Tom. Not a clue how these songs went. And they were on a screen in the ceiling so he could read the lyrics along with and he didn't have his glasses on. So he always looks passionate because he's in pain from the wheel and he's squinting trying to have a little read, you know. And it took forever watching him do it because he'd come on and he'd go, okay. Do you like soul music? lovely idea. And it just took forever doing this show. And he finished off with, you know the U2 song, Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For? He finished off with that, and he did the cracking version, and the audience just stood in front of him all clapping and dancing, and this one bloke, instead of facing Tom, faced the screen and started reading along with, you know, Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. And you know some people have to move their lips when they read, and he was one of them, and so he was doing that, and Tom's behind him, full showbiz Monty, and there's a bloke just stood in front of him, just going, and trying to clap and not being able to do it in time at all, and he's just going... And I mean, watching this, I'm thinking, when that goes out on TV, that's going to look pretty embarrassing for Tom there, you know, he's blocked him right in front. Turns out it was Joe Cocker, they're doing this duet, and they forgot to mark him up completely. But when I was a kid, I always wanted to go to gigs, but music's always been a big part of my life, and I was never allowed to. There was this thing in 1979, some of you probably remember, when these 12 people were killed at a Who gig, they were crushed to death. They just 12 people just went to see the Who, and more than 12, obviously, it would have been shit if just 12 went and all killed themselves. That would have been a pretty bad gig, wouldn't it? I think it'd be impossible if there were just 12 of you. I think you'd have to run at each other really fast. It'd be all right, the last one would be buggered, wouldn't he? You'd be thinking, oh, I've had a pack now. My generation's nearly finished. What am I going to do, you know? And he'd have to lay down and pile the bodies on top of him and flip them upwards. I don't know. It'd be like a bundle. Do you have bundles at school or pylons or whatever? Just vicious. Yeah, boys, you. But boys play, you know, they that one game we used to play, and I don't know if anyone else ever played it, called Kirby, and it's like a sad little lonely boys game. You have no friends, and you have a ball and a curb, and you'd throw the ball at the curb, and if the ball bounced back when it hit the curb, yes, Kirby! That was your afternoon there, you know, oh, over the moon. And sometimes it wouldn't come back, and that was really sad because you didn't get a Kirby. You know, oh, I haven't got a Kirby. And you'd also have to walk across the road and go and get your ball, and that was a really sad one. And vicious games were things like going up to British Bulldog, that was one. What happened in that? Because I never played that one, I've heard of this one.
Start with a bloke in the middle,
yeah?
Team on one side, he's supposed to run across and he's got to sort of like tag people and catch them.
Oh, right. And so you bang him! Yeah. Were you still it though? If you punched him really hard in the face, does that mean you're it?
Well, yeah, that's the bloke's version, isn't it?
Right, yeah. I don't think girls played it, really. Did you play British Bulldog at your school? Yeah? But you wouldn't hit people in the face. You'd go, ooh. Is that something like that? Don't. Something like that. Really, there'd be big girls fighting, and I'm just getting turned on now, just even carrying on. So there'd be little one girl in the middle, just like this, and then loads and loads of girls running at her. You see, blokes would love to play that game if the girls were running at them, and then they've just got to grab girls wherever they can. God, that's like the dream boy game, isn't it? When you're about 15, you just, oh, anything for that game. Especially because the 11-year-old girls are very interested in you at that age as well. Not so much at 30, sadly, but there you go. I think I've let out too much, haven't I? But a boys' game, mate, this is a boys' game, I don't know if girls ever played this one, is going up to another boy and saying, hold out your hand and close your eyes, and then punching him really hard in the face and running off. That's quite a sophisticated one. But the actual, you know, the pivotal boys' game was bundle or pylon or whatever, which you can only really play with your best mate because you can only catch him out. And your best mate, when you're a 10-year-old boy, means everything in the world to you. He's like, not in a homosexual way, but he's just your best friend, and you wake up every morning, you want to tell him what happened on telly last night, all the things that are happening in your life have happened with him, and you'll be stood chatting with him. Someone you've never met will come and kneel behind him, and you'll think, oh, well, now here's my... I've got... Oh, here's my best friend, but I could break his back with virtually no effort now, and I'd look good, and this may never happen again. I'm only 10, I've got to make the most of my life. So you push him, and he'd fall over. He wouldn't just fall, there'd be another boy leaning. He'd be laying there with possibly his back broken, and be laying there, maybe little tears in his eyes, and most of all, that look of betrayal. And you'd be standing there going, yes, I am a great success in this world. There's my best friend there, looking betrayed, never speak to me again, probably never get over the hurt of this betrayal. All I want now is for everyone I've ever met to jump on top of him, and I think the day will be complete. And then you go, bundle, or pylon, or... Doesn't matter how loud you do it, kids have got subsonic hearing at that point. They're like, you could whisper it, you could put it on a piece of Rizzler paper with a Tippex or something like that, and kids, they're like a playground full of meerkats. Thousands, kids you've never met before, running at it, thousands and thousands of kids. People from different countries, there'd be backpackers coming from Holland, we heard there was an injured child, may we dive on top of him. Dinner ladies, mate, now come on, let me on top of the little bastard. The headmaster comes, does a big Fosbury flop on top, and there's the perfect bundle, and that's a good day in a young boy's life. And that, it wasn't like that anyway, thousands of people were at this Who gig, but I wasn't allowed to go to gig. And since I've grown up, I said I've had all these chances to work with all these great people. I did, I once did a show with Snoop Doggy Dogg, you know, the gangster rapper. Obviously, the gangster rapper, not Snoop Doggy Dogg, you know, bus conductor. But I'm really into rap. I don't know if any of you have seen any rap. It's fantastic. Like, if you ever go and see a rap band, because they make you do half the show yourselves, which is quite fun. They always come on, and the first thing they always do is they go, London, make some noise! No, don't do anything. Don't do anything, because that pisses them off. And they're much better when they're pissed off. And you can tell them if it's like they do a funny walk, basically. It's like the rap funny walk. They go, London, motherfucker, motherfucking London, motherfucker. Motherfucking London, motherfucker, motherfucking London, motherfucker. Make some motherfucking noise! And then you go, go on, get on with it. And then they get into it. And then the next part of the show is the shout-outs, where they find out where everyone's from. And they haven't got a chance to go round, but they sort of go, you know, and it sounds brilliant on a rap record. They go, is Long Island in the house? Is Brooklyn in the house? But here they'd be like, is Crowthorne in the house? Is Bagshot in the house? Let me hear you say, Ascot in the house? Is Martin's Heron in the house? And it doesn't sound quite so good. But I did this show with with Snoop Doggy Dogg. And the other guest on the show was Rod Hull of Rod Hull of And Emu fame. And Rod Hull, he's a very lovely old bloke. He's a pensioner, a very frail old professional showbiz type. I don't think he knew who Snoop Doggy Dogg was or that he was up on a murder charge at this point in his life. And, and I don't think Snoop Doggy Dogg knew who Rod... It's very hard to explain to a foreigner what Rod Hull is. Isn't it? It's just like... You know, well, he'll sit there, like, pretending he's not involved, and he's got rags on his hand. And if the rags go like that, he'll have you. That's his job, isn't it? For some reason, we've accepted it through the years that it's entertainment, but he is just a vicious little bastard with rags. That's what he does. So I don't think Snoop knew, and I don't think Rod knew, but we were all looking for the point when Emu went for Snoop. Obviously, that was the bit when some sort of comic mayhem may ensue. And so it was going to happen at the end of the show, and I had a little puppet, and I was going to get another guest, and then that's when Rod Hull and Emu had to get Snoop Dogg. So anyway, I turned around. All right, good night from all of us, Rod, Snoop, whatever. Turned around, got the other guest, and then about 2 minutes later, when I'd finished, and the credits had finished rolling, I turned back round, and Rod Hull's fucked off. But I haven't got a clue where he is, and Snoop Doggy Dogg stood there like this. He's been threatened really badly in his hood. Right, and I never found out. And then about 3 months later on, and I think a mark of what my life has become, I met Rod Hull again. You know, I've met him twice in my life. That weird. So I bumped into his radio station. I said, what happened that night? And he said, I don't think Snoop took it in the spirit it was intended. And I said, well, what did he do? He said, well, I went for him with Emu, like you said, and he knocked me to the ground and stood on my neck till the end of the show. So when I'm there looking for him, he's got a rapper on his head and he's laying underneath the table. So that was a very weird thing. But these rappers, they're generally, even if you see like, you look like Charles Manson, I'm sorry. No disrespect, although obviously a little bit, but imagine you're halfway through a comedy gig and there's fucking Manson sat there. And those people I thought were your family, but they've started to shy away from you there now. It's a great look to go for in the 90s, though, because he was a very popular leader, wasn't he? Now, rappers, even if you see someone like Snoop Doggy Dogg, it's very overstaffed. There's one who does the rap, and he employs another man to be on stage with him, and he looks hard. He's a bloke that looks hard, and he agrees with the man at the front. So, and this is how you look hard if you're a rapper. This is how you look hard. That's really fucking hard in Brooklyn. That's like really hard. And so there's one at the front doing all the legwork. He's doing all the old folks hate my guts because I'll be sticking all their daughters in their big fat butts. He's doing all that. And the one at the back just walks around. And every now and again, he'll walk forward and he'll go, yeah. And he's off looking hard again for the rest of the gig. And sometimes, like, we know they work together, but sometimes he pretends he hasn't heard him. That's the comedy bit of the show. And he'll come forward and he'll go, say what? He goes off again. But if you go and see gangster rappers, I know they don't play in Bracknell, of course they don't. You know, Ice Cube's thinking, world tour, warm up in Bracknell, always do, always good for me. But gangster rappers, obviously, their whole thing is they come on and they talk about violence and being gangsters and various ways to murder another human being with various tools and implements and stuff. And they're so angry, they get out of their limousines, these millionaires, and come and tell you all about their ghetto life. And they come on and they're just murdering people for 3/4 an hour. Bop, bop, bop the motherfucker in the motherfucking head. Gonna stab the motherfucker till the motherfucker's dead. First I assassinate him, then I cremate him, then I take the fucking ashes and evaporate him. And it's like 3/4 an hour. And at the end, they walk off and they go, peace. The best show, if you ever get a chance to go and see a show, go and see Slade 2. Oh, marvellous. All the original members, apart from Noddy Holder, the lead singer. But that's all the other little goofy Dave Hills in the band and Don Powell, their original drummer, still there, which I think is the mark of respect, because Don Powell, I think it was in the 80s, he had a horrific car accident, and he's got chronic amnesia, he's got a 15-minute memory. And I just think, what a sweet thing that they've kept him in the band, you know. That they could have got another drummer, but they haven't. They've kept him in, his original member. I'm sure he's not the most expensive drummer in the world, you know. I'm sure when he gets time to get paid, they're going, oh, we paid you half an hour ago, Don, you know. But the sweet thing is that... before each gig, and they're a working band, they're working every night one place or another. Before each gig, they have to teach him all the Slade songs, right? They have to sit down with him and go through every single Slade song. But then when it happens on stage, they're fantastic to watch live. for about 15 minutes. They're fantastic. And then there does come a point in the gig where Don Powell sat there, he's drumming away, he's having a brilliant time, you know, and suddenly he stops and he goes... Is that Slade? that's a good bit of the gig. Excuse me a second, I'm going to go and pull my pants out of my arse. Oh, someone clapped then. It was just a feeble little clap. Someone just went, just for me, wiping my face. I didn't really enjoy the comedy, but he's very good at wiping his face, really is. Whenever he gets hot, just up there with a towel. Oh, he's magnificent at it. He seemed to get all the moisture off almost immediately. I didn't want to give him a big round of applause, but, you know, a gesture at least. That's all he needed. He had a good laugh then. He did a proper laugh. That's what the laugh comedian's dream of. Doesn't happen. It only happens in sitcoms. Yeah, I've never seen that before in my life. A proper, you know, people laugh and they always look a bit stupid and everything. But he did a proper throw your head back and ha! The evil landowner. everyone's got a weird laugh. A friend of mine has got the best laugh I've ever heard. He doesn't seem to understand the concept of laughter. And he just laughs once. And he doesn't smile. His shoulders don't wobble. He doesn't look stupid. He just goes, ha! And that's it. You know, everyone else has sat around laughing, going, huh? And that's it. He's had a good time. We're happy with him. And once, I wish to God I could remember what it was, because it would you would die. I'm sure you would. You would. He would. I can't remember. Once he laughed twice, and it must have been the most hysterical thing. And it was a beautiful thing to hear, because I didn't know what was going to happen after the first one. I never heard it. Huh? As it always, and the second time, he just raised it slightly, and it was poetry. He went, huh? That was it, that was his laugh. Yeah. It must be one, you know, sometimes you see something and it just cracks you for no reason. I was once on a bus and this Muslim woman got on the bus, you know, dressed all in the yashmak, you know, with the slit and it looking like Satan's postbox. And she came, she got on the bus and she had her photo card for the bus pass, right? And she handed it to the driver who, you know, for the benefit of everyone else on the bus, just a very funny man, he went... What's happening to you? You all right? This is freaking me out. Black with broken back, Charles Manson, man with an eye patch. Is this an average audience here? It's like, well, they're fights for the best seats or something. What's that? I know now I've asked you, it's going to be something really horrific that I will have to walk off the stage from and apologise and get in my car and go home, but what happened?
Got a bit of metal in my eye.
Bit of metal in your eye? Yeah. Fuck, that probably hurts, though. That was all the medical knowledge I've got. I shouldn't joke, should I? Well, no, I should. Because I'm a comedian and we're doing a video, but I shouldn't. Not really about his eye. Because how did it happen? You didn't fall from a great height, did you? Imagine that, if you'd fallen and they're just like, you know, a little bit of metal there and you got that in your eye as well. You'd be pissed off, wouldn't you, eh? Imagine if all the bad luck in Bracknell this week happened just to you. Suddenly grew a big beard looking like Charles Manson, fall from a great height, broke your back and a patch in your eye. And just sat at the front with no one else here tonight. And I had to just come on and try and make you laugh. And you couldn't even do the throw back your head laughter because you're back. Ha! I bet you were pissed off then. I bet you go, and I normally do that sort of laugh, Mark. I don't know why you're talking, I just can't do it tonight. Tonight the laugh I'm doing is that. It's sign language laughter. That's the only laugh I can do tonight. I can't do it. Ha! I get fucking agony. I can just... I once done a gig for the deaf. And it was strange. It was strange because I thought it was to raise money for the deaf, and it was the deaf, and it was the. Oh, that was an hard one. And I, because even when they're having a good time, a lot of them don't speak and they're not used to hearing their own voice, and they don't laugh either. You know, you can see them having a good time, but it was a tough gig, and I went on nervous and worried. And there was a bloke next to me on the stage doing the sign language. And in the end, it was a brilliant gig, and I had a really good time. And I left, I've done me bit, you know. And I felt self-righteous and good about myself. And then weeks later on, I found out that the bloke doing the sign language was doing his own material. You know, it changes things slightly, I suppose. Oh yeah, I was talking about when I was a kid, I used to go in my local pub. None of you have ever had a local pub. You've always had just dead pubs a long way away, presumably. Oh, we didn't have a local, that was too common for us. We'd have to travel to our pub. We had a local pub, but it was in Rio or somewhere. But in my local pub, the Cock Robin in Swindon, there was a great entertainer, and probably some of the older people remember this. There would be an organ player and a drummer in a pub, and they'd play all the hits of the day. And in our pub, it was Alf. He was a brilliant organ player, as far as I could tell. And he would do all the hits. So, did
That's your organ playing. You couldn't do it. That's where your organ playing is. You can't. It's none of that. If you're looking keen and happy, then you're a good organ player. And he'd play all the hits of the day, and he was fantastic. And the best night of the week was Thursday, because he was a big Jimi Hendrix fan. And on Thursday, he'd do a whole tribute show, the Alf Hendrix Experience, and we'd go and watch that. And he'd do all the stuff. And none of you have seen Hendrix done properly, unless you've seen it done by a fat, balding bloke from the West Country on an organ. All the delights of that night. The whole night. Purple A's all in my brain. Genius. Hey! Jew! Where you got with that gun in your hand, you old buggy? And he would do all the Hendrix stuff. Like Hendrix would set fire to his guitar, and Alf, you know, we couldn't expect him to do that, but he'd stub fags out on the organ. I don't know if that's part of the show. And at the end, the big highlight was he'd play with his teeth, he'd take them out and smack them down there on the keyboards, and he'd have a brilliant time there. Oh, but sorry, I've got to go and wipe my face again. Yeah! Yeah, I was giving you a bit of warning so you could all get keen and looking, because I think last time I did it, only one person really enjoyed it, and I wanted the show to be for everyone. You know, I'm not elitist, so here we go, Bracknell. I bet that's landed somewhere really shit now, isn't it? And there's a big shit stain down one side of it that you couldn't see till now. Oh, no, it's going to look awful there, isn't it? So I'll leave it. Nice book. Yeah, and he can kick tails as well. Not only can he use them for their proper purpose, but he can fucking kick them. The Oxford United Tail Kickers. That could be a good name for a women's football team, couldn't it? Red striped shirts. We're the Tail Kickers and we're not in a good mood. Don't fuck with us. Don't come near our ball. Again, I don't care. I enjoyed it. I think it's time for me to go. Before I go, when I'm on stage, I do try and... what you've seen so far has been stupid comedy nonsense, but I think every comedian should talk about something that's important to them and that actually matters in their life. And when you look around the world, obviously there are a great many things that are going on. A lot of injustice and agony, wars, famine, poverty. I don't really care about any of that, I've got to be honest. But the one thing that does get my goat is... all I care about is how much I want to fuck up E17. That's all that matters to me. There's not a day goes by that it doesn't go through my head in some way. So, for the last few years, I've been trying to set up this wind-up, and a proper one, not like a Bracknell wind-up. You know, a Bracknell wind-up is like you meet someone and go, hello, my name's Len. Hello, Len.
Not really.
I've been here before. I know your attitude. A proper big biblical wind-up. And what I'm going to do is, next time E17 do a tour, and they always finish a tour at Wembley Arena, all those boy bands do, I'm going to buy all the tickets. Immediately, 12,000 please, and it's going to be the quickest selling gig in history, and then I'm going to fill it out with you lot and another 11,500 people and stuff. So we all sit there, we're all waiting there for E17, and they're presumably pretty excited. Quickest selling gig in history, 12,000, and it's worth it for me, and I'll pay for taxes, hotels, anything, you know. It really would be worth every penny I've ever. So and also the first probably 20-30 rows has got to be your grandparents. It's got to be, and not none of your jolly still got the disco grandparents. These are you waiting for the hip replacement, the dribblers, but you know, you know, the asthmas, all the, they're the ones, they're the first, the no teeth, the chewing, the sweet, all there, they're the first 20-30 rows, right? We sit at the back, the rest of the others, 10,000 of us or whatever. And E17 finally come on. Big night for them, ladies and gentlemen. E17. And they come on doing their stupid pretending to be black dances and stuff like that. Looking all hard like little 12-year-old boys doing their thing. And they finally, all excited, all action on the stage, they finally get to the end of the first song. And we all go... And we look down and keep our heads down throughout the entire show. But don't worry, after about the fifth or sixth song, someone will come and hand out magazines and papers and we can sit there having a little read, you know, maybe Game Boys or whatever, you know. I don't know what we do for you, we're just a massage or something, I don't know what it'll be. But... And then after about the eighth or ninth song, knitting and crocheting handed out to the front rows and they're just sitting there and a little knit away. E17 have to battle away, do the old show and everything. And finally they finish, they've been on for an hour and a half, we haven't looked up for a second, there's been no eye contact after the first song. Presumably they're not very happy. And so they finish off with, like, you always have to finish off show like this, right, showbiz, you have to go, Wembley, you've been fantastic. Right, just about to walk off, and as they're walking off, we haven't even fucking noticed they're on, but as they're walking off, an old man, the oldest man we can find, at least 125, right, it's got to be, I'm hoping for the oldest man in the world in my dream, but it doesn't have to be, just an old man, he stood at the back of Wembley Arena, and as they're walking off to this silence, he's got a mic, and you hear him going, more. Come on, a bit more, lads, a little bit more.
And in show business, that's an encore, you've got to do it, right? So they have to come back on. But throughout that last song, we've kept his mic up, right? Asthma, bad. So he's, throughout the last song, all we can hear, we can see them, all of that, but all we can hear is... So finally, finished the last song. I'm just about to walk off Wembley being fantastic again, right? They're not in a good mood at this point. And he goes, hold on, lads. Hold on. Oh, right. And he starts making his way down Wembley Arena. It's a long old walk for a young man. He's 125. Takes him at least 2 hours. 2 hours. If he gets there any quicker than that, we turn him around, he wouldn't notice. He'd start walking back the other way. So they've had to stand there looking hard for 2 hours. Hold on, lads. Hold on. Hold on. Finally gets to the front of the stage. Lifts up his walking stick, all the effort he's got. Points it out. Accidentally jabs one of them really hard. That doesn't really have to happen, but it's just, you know, I'd like it to. He might not have the energy for that at that point. So anyway, they aren't looking hard and he goes, I just wanted to let you know, I'm an old man. You probably, you don't notice that. This could be the last night of my life. I've seen some things, a lot of things I missed, of course, but I haven't been out of the house for 40 years because I pissed myself. And you probably noticed that my trousers are like, feel like flannels at the moment, but anyway. I've seen a lot of things in my life, and have I said this? I think I have. I've seen many unhappy things. I've seen wars, I've seen the depression, I've seen the woman I love die in my arms. But watching you tonight, I was up the back there watching you, and it took me back to my childhood when I was a young 14-year-old boy, also from Wolverhampton. I was standing there staring, I was seeing you lovely young fit lads jumping about, having a lovely time. I wanted to tell you, I couldn't really hear any of it. Good night. Wow, God, the excitement for me, having an audience that haven't paid asking for more. You know what? I don't think I could be happier this evening. I wonder if there's any of this we can fucking use in the video. It's just a greasy, sweaty man swearing. That's all it is, isn't it? People, when they meet me, they always think I'm in a bad mood because, you know, I don't smile that much or anything, and people are always coming up to me and going, oh, I've seen you on television, you're very cynical, very bitter, aren't you? Very unhappy with your life. And I go, no, that's just an actor playing television. You are fucking me off at the moment, but generally, I'm a very reasonable man, you know, and people don't realise that about me. I once won the West Country Heat of the Most Reasonable Man in Britain competition, and I didn't, to be fair, I didn't win, I came second, but I caused such a fucking fuss at the bloke that won. He just handed it over to me, you know, he was obviously a very reasonable man. All right, have you not been enjoying it?
I have indeed. Yeah. Now.
Take the fuck off. You know what? I hadn't thought of that. I've got a message from Mum. What
What sort of, what should I do it, sort of gently or a real vicious one?
Is that
real fisty?
Yeah.
Fuck off! That worked for me, that was great. That was like, can you do a dedication for us? Well, no, it was like, take the fuck off. He could have heard you if you'd have said it. Oh no, I had to be the bad guy, yeah, again. And what I was going to say about going to see other comedians to fuck them up is what you do is the silent thing's very good and then catch them off guard because when you're up here, it's hard to construct and stuff anyway. And one of my favourite stories is there's a comedian on stage dying dismally. And for about a quarter of an hour, he's been on nothing, not a titter, but no one's shouting at him. They're just pretty much, you know, just sitting there with that look that you do so well. And and it's so hard for him. He just knows he can't get off yet or he won't be paid, but he has to keep going on and no one's interested. And he's just trotting out his tired old comedy wares. And then suddenly someone, just from out of the darkness, someone went, look, what do you want? And that's a good one. But my favourite one, that's nothing compared to my favourite one. My favourite one was involved a female comedian. She was on stage, she's wearing this miniskirt, doing her business. And at the front, there's tables just around the front of the stage. And there was a bloke heckling her with his girlfriend, but very quietly, so the rest of the audience couldn't hear. And every time she walked past him, he was going to her, I can smell your cunt. But, and she couldn't... She couldn't normally have a heckle and go, what did you say? But she couldn't do that, obviously. And no one else could hear it. She's trying hard. His girlfriend's pissing herself. But no one else has heard it. So she's like trying to figure out where she is in her set and what she's trying to talk about. And every time she has to walk back past this bit of the stage, I can smell your cunt. And his girlfriend's on the fucking floor by this point. And she said the worst thing about the story was that she hadn't had a bath that day. She wasn't sure if it was true or not. You know, so that fucked things up. I think it is time for me to leave my foul mouth and go. Thank you, man. Hey. I'm going to leave you on a note of love because you two seem to be in love and that's nice. And a lot of what I've talked about throughout the show has been women with smelly cunts and little boys having to gobble off old men and fucking midgets and people with broken backs and everything. It's been a distasteful evening, hasn't it? So I'm going to leave on a note of love because it's nice that you say. How long have you been together, you two?
10 years.
10 years, so the magic's worn thin. But they still seem happy and that's really nice, you know. A lot of us don't believe it can happen, but seeing like, you two together there, you've made my evening, to be honest. Every time I look over, Charles Manson, oh, love, ah. You know, and it's been yin and yang for me in this audience. That's nice. You know, if he wasn't here, I would have felt a bit sick, to be honest, but he's evened it up a little bit. Can you remember how you met? What was the chat-up line or anything? Strip poker, we were all there, the whole town. No, it's very exciting, that early stage of love, isn't it? When you know, you just... Anything that happens with that other person, so exciting, just on the phone for hours at a time. Yeah. You've got to know the other person before you do it, right? Don't be ringing up strangers again, not with your voice. That would be scary. So you're on the phone for hours, and then finally you put the phone... You've been on there for like 2 days, you're dying to go to the toilet, you wet yourself, you haven't eaten, and you're so in love, and everything's really happy and jolly. Because you're like a four-year-old kid when you fall in love, aren't you? Anything. You know, like when you're a kid and you just sing and dance for no reason. You just like, wake up, sing and dance again today. You know, it's like jazz, and your mum's going, tidy up your room, and you just sing and dance. I am going to tidy. No sense of rhythm or tempo or melody. Tidy up my room. Tidy up my room. Go and tidy up your room because my mummy said so. But when you're in love, everything's like that. You just feel like that all the time. And then you get to a stage when you have to tell the other person you love them, which that's a hard one for anyone to do because you don't know that it's going to be returned. And it's got to be equal. You couldn't say to someone, I love you, and they go, oh, cheers. You know, it's got to be an equal thing, obviously. And women, I don't know if men play this game, but women certainly play the game. And like, I love you. The biggest thing you can say to another human being, sure, even if it's a lie, you know, quite a big one to tell. And that's an important thing. But women always do that, like, how much? I don't know, what's the scale? What is it? 2 skips full. Is that enough? I don't know. What's... Scale is 1 to 10. How much do you love me? 1 to 10. 10? Yeah, you mean 4. But you go, 10 maximum. And they go, I love you. 12, you cheating, lying, evil bastard. You've seen other women, haven't we? I'm sure you have. Then there comes the stage, the nickname stage. I'm sure you're well past that now, aren't you, when you have to give each other a nickname? That's it. Look, he's going, oh my God, don't bring that up. You feel now like we've all been invited just to bring up your nickname, aren't you? I don't know what it is,
thanks,
obviously.
Mate, yeah.
But what was it, though?
What was it?
What, sorry?
What was your nickname?
Weebles.
Weebles. Not as in wobble, but I don't fall down, as in small
no,
bollocks.
As in, yes.
That's a tough one, isn't it? Because the worst thing about the nickname is like it's a new name. It's a name for your love. You know, it's like, well, everyone else goes, what's your real name?
Duncan.
All right, this video's going to be a fucking treat for you to buy, isn't it? And your the mates at work.
Christmas present sorted out.
Yeah, for all your mates at work, they can go, oh, Weebles, he's got us a nice video. But normally nicknames, you have to have one back, and that's a tough one. You have to go, I love you so much, I've got you a new name. And I have to love it. I've got one back, and it's got to be an equal one, you know. If it's like Fluffy Bunny, you can't go, you know, Pigeon Head. It's got to be something like, it's got, I don't know what Weebles, what were you called? Meccano set or something. Something not very loving, I'd imagine. I only ever had one once, it was Kitten. I used to call me Kitten, and I used to hate it because I used to think I'm not soft and fluffy, you know, I'm not like a kitten. I don't cough up furballs, you know, I don't shit on gravel. I don't know what you're on about, to be honest. And it wasn't until we split up, and you know, sometimes you always say, oh, when you split up, you always go, but we'll still remain friends. And we did, and we worked very hard at it, you know, and she worked very hard at it by fucking my other friends. And that was cute because, no, that was nice for me because at least I could smell her every now and again on fingers. Anyway, it wasn't until we split up that I found out that I was called Kitten because my breath smells like cat food, you know, but I didn't know that at the time. I'm disgusting myself now. I'm going home. Good night. Thank you again.